Thank you. I don't know how many years religious and other intervening. It is today a wonderful, interactive session that I really enjoyed from 1996 till 2000. Almost there was no getting in that I didn't present in this. So it was a very good forum for a young consultant or a young trainee to project this activities. So it's very nice that I thought of the 16 which is every year the hall should be full. See, the prize doesn't reward, punishment is the best reward. So I think we should do something like that. Thank you. Welcome. The first case is Medicine Pie by Dr. Arun Joseph, new lady with dancing.
Good evening. I'm Arun. I'm presenting a case from Medicine 5. My case topic is a mute lady with a dancing tongue. This is a lady who had presented to my OPD around 2 weeks back. She had come to me exactly like this. She had come with a history that within a span of 7 days, she had developed rapid onset worsening mutism, which was initially present for 4 days, following which complete stiffness of bilateral upper limb, bilateral lower limbs, followed by inability to walk. She has continuous drooling of saliva from the angle of mouth. She was breathing heavily when she came to my OPD. The husband was holding the patient, held her in both the relatives were either side of the patient. She couldn't walk by herself. The patient's relatives brought her inside and then put her in the bed. So when I asked history about the patient, the history from the family, they told me this patient was okay till around 20 days back. 20 days back, she apparently had some history of increased speaking. Following that, some relatives, the local village doctor had given some injection. That is the only thing the particular family at that time knew. He was going on blaming the injection for whatever was happening. Then according to him, for next 14 days, patient was okay. Then the last 7 days before presentation to my OPD, the patient developed rapid onset, first mutism, followed by bilateral upper limb and lower limb, stiffness and couldn't walk. On examination, first is expression, no, there is no expression on the face. She was not aware of the surroundings. She was completely mute. So whenever I was asking her to do something, mostly she won't do anything, but whenever I used to ask her to lift her hands or something, sometimes she will lift her hands. Her heart rate when she came was 126 per minute, BP was 80/60, respiratory was 20 per minute. She had significant posturing. I had put her on the bed, then every 2 minutes she will just suddenly get up like a zombie and sit there. And then she will start drooling saliva, then we will take out the drool and then she fall down again. Cardiovascular respiratory system examination was harsh, conducted sounds, cardiovascular was normal, abdomen was normal. CNS examination, she was a right-handed patient. I tried to do the cranial nerve examination first. Cranial one couldn't be checked. Cranial nerve 2, light reflex was present. There was no RAPD. There was no papilloid edema. 3, 4, 6, she was not obeying my commands at all. So I couldn't check the movements in that directions. There was, on cranial nerve 5 examination, there was no wasting in the temporalis or masseter muscle. There was no excited jaw jerk. Corneal unconjunctival reflex was present. 7th nerve, there was no visible facial deviation, but she won't respond to my commands, so I couldn't check more. There was frowning was equal, and continuous drooling of saliva from the angle of mouth was present. 8th nerve could be checked. 9th and 10th, I couldn't get to the gag properly. There was some amount of movement, but the mouth was almost completely shut. She won't open it for me even after trying. 11th nerve could be checked. 12th nerve, I could see from the tongue appeared to be contracting slightly, but I couldn't really appreciate because it's almost completely tight. Motor examination, upper limb, because she could lift her hands in between, I thought 3 to 4/5 upper limb should be there. Lower limb, almost, she was moving in between, she could walk, but she was not responding to my commands. Tone, it was rigidity in all upper limb and lower limb. It was like a cogwheel rigidity. Bulk was equal. Reflexes all were 3+. The angle reflex, however, was clonus, and there was a Babinski reflex was flexor. Sensory examination couldn't be really checked, but she was localizing to pain. Significant neck rigidity was there. Spine was grossly normal. Cerebellum and gait was not checked. My first thought was, because he was blaming on the injection so much, I first thought he said something like, the patient is going to posturing because of tetanus. Because only 7 days before she was okay, after that injection suddenly she has become like this. Then other thing was rabies. Was the injection because some psychiatric medicine? That was the other thing I was thinking. Because I had seen some cases of dystonia before, but I was not sure it's an extrapyramidal syndrome because of that. The other thing I got thought was, he's actually, because the patient had been seen by an outside doctor, they had thought this probably the patient had some psychiatric manifestations. I read about catatonic schizophrenia, maybe it was that. Other things I thought was some autoimmune encephalitis or a viral encephalitis sequelae. Others were Wilson's disease or heavy metal poisoning with sequelae because of that. This was the patient I admitted. So my impression was the patient with predominantly extrapyramidal symptoms with some pyramidal symptoms with the extra reflexes and all. This was how the patient was looking for the first 3 days. Completely mute, lying down, in between every 5 minutes you just get sit up, starts drooling saliva, again fall down by herself. So initial investigations mainly was normal. I had sent all this because we were not exactly sure of the diagnosis when the patient had come. And she was breathing so heavily, we were wondering there was some stridor, but she was maintaining saturation. VDR, a thought of CNS syphilis and a VDR was sent. We did an MRI brain the same night, it was normal. CSF also was normal only. Heavy metal screening was sent later on, but came normal. Thyroid I had checked, CPK was normal. But our main reason we thought about this thing was that some of my consultants had seen something similar to this, and I also seen something in which the extra pyramidal symptom that he had somehow made me feel that maybe the primary problem was that injection itself. We had never seen even I called psychiatry next day. When they had come, they felt that whatever was happening was more like an extrapyramidal dystonia because of a drug. And we got the drug name, it was a flufenacin drug. Now flufenacin is actually an antipsychotic which used to be used quite often earlier, but the problem is it has a very strong potential to cause extrapyramidal symptoms, because primarily it is an anticholinergic action. This is an anti-dopamine action is the problem here. So it blocks the caudate putamen and globus nucleus. Clinical features, usually when you see the patients it usually happens within 96 hours of the injection usually, but it might be present even like a week later. It usually affects only the head and neck area. Even the consultant who had come to see the patient, he had hardly ever seen something such a generalized dystonia. Most of the time they will have something like a torticollis or something mainly in the eye or in the face, in which our differential will be more easier, because we would have probably thought of it early. Because of such a generalized thing, even we were not sure till the next day. Here the patient, usually whenever you do this, what we think about is whether an acute emergency. The emergency in these cases is whether the patient is going to something like a laryngospasm. Because it was mainly in saturation, we were closely observing the patient, we had not worried about it at that time. The differential that we thought was whether there was a stimulation or a conversion disorder. This catatonia was definitely one thing we were thinking about. Tardive dystonia usually happens after like a prolonged use of antipsychotic drug. Other things can be temporal epilepsy or hypercalcemia. The other drugs that can cause these things are anti-vertiginous drugs like cinnarazine, flunarazine, anti-convulsive like carbamazepine, phenytoin, and anti-malarial drugs. The treatment for this is actually to immediately give one shot of either an anticholinergic or an antihistaminic drug. For this patient, what we did is we just gave an antihistaminic drug. The other thing we decided is immediately started the patient on anticholinergics. The main thing here was that the difference we saw in 2 days. The patient came so sick within the next day after giving him the injection. By evening, patient started slowly opening mouth. By next day itself, the patient was able to move the upper limb and lower limbs, and by third day he was walking. One thing I learned here is that if you could pick up the diagnosis in the first or second day, this is one disease in which the patient looks extremely sick, completely dependent on you. Diagnose it. In 2 days, the patient will have completely reversible disease. That's why I thought this is something a clinician should have seen at least once in their life. Helps you to diagnose quite easily. So acute management is anticholinergic, antihistaminics, followed by maintenance of anticholinergics. We gave for next 4 days triexafenidyl, and by the fourth day, the patient was ambulating and currently has been discharged. The prophylactic, the one thing we should remember is that our problem is sometimes we give anticholinergic drugs ourselves without knowing these things can happen. Problem is that if you give a very potent anticholinergic, Then within the first 96 hours, if we do not expect or we cannot keep that patient in our observation, it's better to give an drug that can be like an anticholinergic in addition to that to avoid this complication. So other worries was that 2 days later the patient's CPK started worsening. That is something we were very worried about, because the first CPK was only 34. We were not thinking of NMS at that point. But once the CPK started worsening, we were thinking whether the patient is going into NMS. So here I think as a clinician this is something also you should know a little bit, because problem is that patient was improving, CPK was worsening. Because we have not seen it so much, we are worried whether actually he was worsening into, but actually if it is an NMS, the things that we usually look for is basically the patient should have features like an altered mental status, muscular rigidity, tremor, hypothermia. Of this, the patient had initially altered mental status which has improved, muscular rigidity was improving, tremor and hypothermia. So instead of trusting the biochem value of CPK, we trusted the patient is improving and we just gave adequate hydration. 3 days later, patient is completely settled and is other things we can look in NMS is to look for leukocytosis, elevated LDH alkaline phosphatase, hypercalcemia and hypomagnesemia. For this patient, maximum it went to 1340. Following that, within the next 2-3 days, it started settling down completely and the tone and the movement was also improved. Our patient improved and was discharged. The things to learn here is how to identify a patient for dystonia. Second thing is to have a clinical suspicion of something like an antipsychotic drug being the primary cause when the patient presents with extrapyramidal symptoms, and that is very rapid onset and we have some history which vaguely suggests that he might have got some injection in the recent time. Thank you. Is psychotic. Actually, sir, there is two preparations for that. The acute one apparently stays only for 7 days, but this patient received a depot preparation. This depot preparation stays for at least 3 weeks. That is what. After we started the patient on appropriate medicines, third day the patient is able to walk, and I want to show you a video also. This was once the patient actually walked, like started becoming better, and I could ask the patient to open the mouth. This is like a tongue dystonia that is just probably happening even at that time, but we couldn't appreciate because we couldn't even open at all.
Comments or questions? There's another issue here is you have to differentiate tardive dystonia from tardive dyskinesia. And if you say tardive dystonia, it's usually much more severe. Yeah. This is a single dose here, most likely itself reversible, it will come back to normalcy. But suppose the refractory, one of the things which is useful and all these drugs do not succeed is to give Botox injection. That helps sometimes up to 6 months, and sometimes it may resolve it forever, especially when the causative agent is taken away.
So for differential diagnosis with tetanus, what made you be sure that you don't have to apply anesthesia?
Two things I could say. He didn't have any. There is no histotonus and all. But we honestly were not sure. It was not any of the other differentials. Still, we had a good outcome actually. Yeah. Sure.
Can you tell from the dynamics of concept between the two?
Sorry?
The dynamics of concept of symptoms and which pattern is becoming longer, slower, or faster?
It will be usually if the patient has tetanus, I think it will be faster than the progression of the disease may be faster, I'm sure. But I'm not sure, I couldn't actually at the time say definitely. I honestly couldn't be very sure that it was not tetanus at that time, yeah. Only from the next day I was sure, because the moment I gave the anticholinergic injection, by within like 20 minutes there was improvement, by evening he could become better. So then I was 100% sure. But definitely there is an error, there is a question of whether it was not tetanus. There was 2-3 things I did. I asked about the injection itself. The only thing I knew was the exposure was that particular injection. I asked exactly and specifically, is there any chance it was an old injection, the needle was new or not. I called that doctor also and asked. That's the only thing I could at that point do to eliminate any cause of injection. But I couldn't honestly say it was not tetanus at that point.
You have vaccination history?
Sorry, sir?
Did you have vaccination history?
Yes, sir. She was vaccinated before.
To close the question here.